When most people want some more randomness in their life, they will turn to something like a dice, for example, a D20. And that's fine if you want a whole number between 1 and n, but I like more nuanced random numbers. So I use the random function on the calculator on my phone, which you're not going to drop. You're going to lower it in. We're not setting up some kind of thank you comedic premise here. So if I push that random button on my calculator, you'll see I'm getting random numbers, importantly, between 0 and 1. And that's like randomness classic, reels from 0 to 1. And once we've got one of these random numbers, we can do something with it. So for example, you could take a random number and you could calculate its square root. Or you could take two random numbers and calculate which one's bigger. And it turns out those two operations are mathematically equivalent. It's true, they're the same thing. The first time I heard this fact, I was like, no, that's not true, but it is. And then I told the fact to Grant Sanderson from 3blue1brown. He said, no. And then he realized, like, no, wait, that is true. So I was like, oh my goodness, this is such an obscure, but an incredible fact. And it's true. If you were in a room doing one of these two operations, and you didn't tell me which, but you gave me the results, I could not distinguish one of them from the other. So we're gonna have a closer look at this, and we're gonna prove that it's definitely true. Also, there'll be more dice. I was sent this fact by someone named Dylan from Seattle, a viewer of my videos. They emailed to say they were asking ChatGPT to plot a variety of random-based functions. So for completeness, we're gonna start with just plotting a random number between 0 and 1. It's completely uniform. Every real number between 0 and 1 is equally likely. We do have to deal with the infinite elephant in the room though, which is that there are uncountably infinitely many real numbers between 0 and 1. So technically they each have a probability of 0 of being picked. So they're all not gonna be picked. But that's only because real numbers have infinitely many digits, decimal places. So what we're actually gonna do is split the number line up into tiny, tiny bins, which is why on the phone, it's giving me real numbers, but only to 15 decimal places. So it's 10 to the 15 little buckets that we're going into. So each of them does have a very small, but non-zero probability. So when I say real number or whatever, that's what I mean. We're using little buckets. It's fine. It's not rigorous, but it's fine. We can now take all those random numbers between 0 and 1, and Dylan asked ChatGPT to show, for example, the square, if you squared them all. That's what you end up with. That's the distribution where the height shows you the probability of getting that value. What if we did two random numbers multiplied together? Subtly different. That's what you get. You can take, I don't know, the minimum of two random numbers. You can take, and here it comes, the maximum of two random numbers, and then you can take the square root of one random number. And Dylan realized those last two plots were identical. They emailed this to me. I was like, no. So I plotted them myself, and yes. And then I realized that maximum plot was a bit familiar. I made a video a year or two ago about if you have two D6 dice and you roll them both, then choosing the highest, which if you're playing Dungeons and Dragons is rolling a dice with advantage, I analyzed what the average value is if you do that for dice of different sizes, including of course the D20. I then had a look at what the distributions appear like, and you may find it very familiar. I'll link to the whole video below, but the summary version is if you do the sample space of all 36 combinations of two D6s being rolled, and then you group them into the ones with the same highest value, there's only one square, which if you roll both dice, the highest value is a 1. So that's a 1 in 36 chance. There are 3 where the biggest value is a 2, 5 for 3, and all the way up. And if you rearrange that into a bar chart, you get pretty much a triangle shape. And if you were to increase the number of sides your dice has, that would eventually approach the same triangle distribution that we saw in, I guess, the extreme version, where you have two numbers between 0 and 1, pick the biggest, and in that limit, you get a perfect triangular distribution. Oh, and if you're bored, you can spend a while staring at that and see if you can work out why that means the average value is 2/3 of the maximum value. So by just taking the limit of a result from a previous video, we're halfway there. Now we just need to know, what does it mean to take the square root of rolling a dice or picking a random number? And this is where it got interesting, because I made the, let's say, mistake of mentioning this to Grant Sanderson when he was visiting me, when he was over in the UK, because I explained roughly where I was at with my thinking, and then he almost immediately came up with a better version. I brought this up with Grant when we were on a train journey together and we were both supposed to be working, and I made the mistake of mentioning a math problem, and I'll talk you through the rough outline that I showed Grant and we filled in some gaps together. And we're gonna call the random number X. None of this is rigorous, by the way. This is our Y equals the square root of X graph. You could just put Y squared equals X. I'm gonna call that DX. It's a little section of this. We can then map that to the amount over here we're gonna get. So we just differentiate both sides. And so we end up with two lots of Y DY equals DX. And I'm gonna leave that as it is for now. The next one I'm gonna draw in a way that is unnecessarily complicated. This is a square. If I fill in the rest of it, there's a square, that's our space. We kind of end up with the outer, I mean, shell's probably not quite the right word, is Y is also just that distance, how far out in the square we've gone, that's also Y. And then that little bit there is DY. That area is our DX. So we can say that total area DX is equal to this rectangle, which is Y times dy plus this area, which is y times dy. Oh my goodness, it equals 2y dy. Dx equals 2y dy. Dx equals 2y dy. This was our hand wavy convincing ourselves, yeah, these two situations, while not in rigorous terms, have the same underlying logic. We convinced ourselves, yeah, it feels like this is a true fact. And then Grant was silent for a second and then said, yeah, but maybe there's a nicer visual way of looking at it. Classic three blue, one brown. And sure enough, he came up with one.
So let's think about one of our random values, which I'm gonna call x1. And we're assuming this is randomly chosen in the interval from 0 to 1 according to a uniform distribution, which in this case just means that the probability of falling within a given range is equal to the size of that range. For the second random value, I'm going to have you think about it on a kind of y-axis. And again, this one is chosen uniformly at random between the values 0 and 1. And by putting it on a second axis like this, it means we can think of all the possible pairs of values, x1, x2, as being a point in two-dimensional space. More specifically, a point inside this little 1x1 square. Now take a moment to think about what it looks like for the maximum of these two values to be equal to some specific number, like 0.7. Well, one way that could happen would be if x1 is equal to 0.7 and x2 is anything smaller than it, which would put us on this vertical line here. But it could also be the case that x2 is equal to 0.7 and x1 is smaller than that, which puts you somewhere on this horizontal line here. In general, when you're dealing with probabilities over continuous values like this, it's not very helpful to ask about equality, like the probability that this max is exactly equal to 0.7, since these lines are infinitesimally thin, so that exact probability is actually zero, and you kind of can't deduce anything about the distribution from that. But what's much more helpful is to switch to inequalities and ask, what's the probability that this maximum is something less than or equal to this specific value, which in our diagram would mean you fall anywhere inside this green square here. In that case, because everything is uniform, the probability equals the area of that little green square. So the probability that your max is below a given value r is always going to equal r squared. There's a fancy name here. This is called the cumulative distribution function for our random variable. On the other hand, suppose you just took one of these values, like x1, and you asked, what's the probability that its square root is less than r? Essentially asking for this cumulative distribution of the square root of a random value. That's the same as asking, when is x1 less than r squared? And because it's uniform at random in this range from 0 to 1, the answer there is r squared, exactly what you get for the maximum case.
Okay, I agree. The visual way of looking at it is really good. It also means we can generalize what we've seen so far. We can take it up into more dimensions, so more random numbers. And if you remember my previous video, those of you who saw it about the dice, you know I went from trying to imagine that 2D square elbow plot using dice up into the third dimension, which we're going to do again. But for that, we need a lot more dice and, oh no! So now we can build a 3D version of the plot we saw before in 2D. We'll start with one dice, and then we build up shells of dice around that to represent a three-dimensional plot where each axis is one of rolling three D6s and then picking the biggest. And this is the same model we had last time, in case you're curious, except we did drop it. And we broke the outer one, which is why it's now shonkier than ever. But it's fine, it's good enough. So what this represents is you get 6 by 6 by 6 cube. So that's taking three distinguishable dice, rolling them, picking the biggest value, which in this case is a 6. And so there's only one way to get one, that's rolling a 1, 1, 1 combo. There's all these ways. There's 7 ways to get a 2, and then you count all the way up. And last time I got obsessed with working out a closed, nice, neat formula using hexagonal numbers to calculate the average result of what you're going to get. What Grant realized is if you generalize his visual proof, the kind of the same way I've done this, you can look at what happens if you pick 3 random numbers between 0 and 1, and it turns out that's indistinguishable from taking their cube root. And 4 random numbers? Well, you imagine the 4D version of this, and that's equivalent to taking the 4th power root of a single random number. Absolutely phenomenal. The question now is, how do we apply this back to rolling dice? We can't just roll, let's say, 1D6 and take its square root to be the equivalent of rolling 2D6s and picking the highest for 2 issues. The first is, and this is something a lot of people get hung up on very early on, we're now dealing with numbers bigger than 1. And a lot of people, when I originally told them this fact, if they weren't mathematical, their first objection is, no, but square roots make things smaller. And that's true if you're above 1. Below 1, because if you multiply something by a number below 1, it gets smaller, squaring goes smaller. If you take the square root, that makes it bigger, which is why from 0 to 1, the square root is equivalent to taking a max. If we're above 1, however, that no longer works. So what you'd need to do is roll the dice, a d6, and then divide whatever you get by 6, and that scales it all down to be between 0 and 1. So for a d20, you'd roll it, divide by 20. We can fix that issue. The bigger issue is the resolution. So if you did it with a d6, and you divide that by 6, you're still only going to have 6 possible values, because there's only 6 faces it can land on. And that's not enough detail to recreate the nuances of that 6 by 6, that 36 value possible space of outcomes. You need to be able to have enough results to proportionally get the different values. So the lack of resolution we cannot fix, or at least we can't fix it with a normal dice like this. I found one dice for which it works. So we no longer need our D20. Instead, we need a D36. If you want to recreate rolling 2 dice and picking the biggest, D6s, you need a single dice which has the square of the number of faces. Instead of 6, you got 36. And that's because it gives you the entire sample space. But the maths works out so nicely. So if you were to roll this and then scale it between 0 and 1, you'd be dividing it by 36, or 6 squared. You then take the square root of whatever you end up with, which is equivalent of whatever you rolled, take the square root, now divided by just a single 6. But then you've got to scale it back up to represent rolling a d6, so you multiply it by that 6. Everything cancels out. So it means if you have a 36-sided dice and you roll it, and you just take the square root of whatever number you see and then round that up to the nearest whole number, that is indistinguishable from rolling 2d6s and picking the highest value. It works! A fact that I came across which seemed unbelievable, and I realized half of the fact applied to something I'd done previously because it's maths. And because the fact was true, I knew somehow the other half must apply as well. The square root must work, and it does. You just gotta pick the right number of sides. Thank you so much for watching this video. Two last things to clear up. One is, where on earth do you get a D36 from? And this shouldn't be possible. Yeah, the fine people at the Dice Lab made this. I don't think it's strictly completely fair. I think they just distributed 36 points on a sphere and then put some planes on it, but I will link to the Dice Lab website below where you can get these. If you're in the UK, I think we'll have some, not many, a handful on Maths Gear. So I'll link to that below as well. And thanks to Dylan from Seattle, who I have to say, did at the time ask ChatGPT why the square root of a random number is the same as the max of two random numbers. And to ChatGPT's credit, they put together something that looks like a lot like a proof involving cumulative distribution functions. I have not gone through it carefully to see if it's actually correct. I would be quite surprised if it was, but it went in the same direction as what Grant did. So well played, ChatGPT. Not as random as I thought it would be.